Thank you very much for inviting me here. I have a question. Seems a small question, but it's a rich question. Who was Carl Gustav Jung?
I think he was pioneer. The pioneer who discovered the psyche. I say a pioneer because Freud is usually taken as the pioneer who discovered the psyche, but he was still in the era of enlightenment. So he missed the irrational side of the psyche, which Jung took into account. So the whole of the psyche is, to my understanding, understood by Jung only. And of course, then this is his message to his fellows, to integrate the rational side of the psyche and the irrational side. And to my understanding, the irrational side, which is, for instance, synchronicity, meaningful incidences, and a lot of happenings which are connected to the psyche, for instance, meaning of diseases. I recently was ill and then I was cured again, and then I told my practitioner, now I see the meaning of the illness. And she was very surprised. Meaning of the illness? For most of the doctors, it's important they diagnose you and they know what you need, but that illness has a meaning is for them quite irrational. So this is, for instance, a part where Jung is not yet understood, and it will take 100 years at least to understand also this side, the irrational of the psyche, because the body and the psyche are in one's personality together, and they respond to each other. There is never an illness without a psychical reaction, and there is never, and this is my hypothesis, illness without psychic meaning. So often, also, when a doctor admits somebody to the hospital with a broken leg, for instance, then he should ask, and why did it happen at this moment? What was the meaning? He cares about the broken leg, and when the broken leg is functioning again, then his task is done. But for the person, it's not finished with that. The person should understand, why did I break the leg at this very moment? So the care, kairos, the moment in which something happens is so important, and this is not yet understood what this could mean. So this is also that psychology, Jung's psychology, is very vast, very comprehensive in different respects. It's not just a medical affair, medical question. The psyche is the whole world. We never can step out of the psyche. We never can look at the psyche from outside. We are bound in this world of the psyche. But we don't understand that the psychical world is immense, is the all, is the universe. And this is not yet understood. We can do no human activity, no human size in any respect without the psyche. And therefore, I think Jung did a lot which has not yet be understood by his followers, which has to be elaborated in different ways. And the interesting thing, I think, is that the new acceptance of Jung comes not from the psychiatry. Even the psychiatrists are more resistant. They never mention Jung. But, for instance, it comes from art. I heard from art historian that they speak about the archetype. The images from the beginning, Urbild, and that they take it up, and already the linguists have taken it already for a long time before Jung up, but in a different way, when they have many manuscripts from an old writer, then they collect it to find the archetype, the initial manuscript. So they speak about the archetype without knowing what you meant by it. So I think it will be discovered not from the specialists, but from anyone who meets this experience. Because Jung is important from his experience, and his so-called theory is not something which he had in his head, although he was a very intelligent person, of course a genius, but he experienced it in his life, and therefore then he collected his experiences and put it in a system. This is called the theory of Jung, but not like with a philosopher from his head, from an idea which he had. No, it was first the experience. And this appeals also to the people who meet Jung in very different respects and very different areas. And they will be the one who discover Jung again in 50 or 100 years, I think.
And what do you think is the relevance of Jung today in 2017, at the beginning of 2017?
Yeah, I think this is also my idea. Every institution is like a kingdom. So, for instance, the EU, the idea of Union of European States, is like a kingdom. In the beginning, it's a wonderful new idea. We collect all the people in Europe, and they have common history, and so they have to be together, and they make a union. This is the original idea. And then the kingdom is established, wonderful, new, and with the time it becomes older, it functions, and people think, well, it's good, yeah, we must improve it even now, and more it becomes the old king. And then it petrifies. Then more and more rules are made. There is an abuse in this respect. So we have to make a rule that there are no more abuses possible. And there is a difficulty here. We have to make a rule. And so they fence themselves in with rules and with laws against these misuses. And so this is coming to become the old king. So every kingdom is in the long run becoming the old king, because the old king cannot renew himself. The old king has to be killed. This was in primitive states, in Rhodesia, for instance, in Africa, where the old king was killed when he was no more a factor of welfare, and fertility. And then he becomes petrified, he becomes stiff, he becomes corrupt. He is only looking to keep his power. He must keep his power, and so on. As soon as somebody has to try to keep his power, then one knows this is the old king. This is no more something alive. And then he has to die, to be killed, that the new king can come. And therefore, in France, for instance, it was said that the king has died, es lebe der König, the new king should live. This is exactly, there should be no interregnum. This is the most difficult time. It was also in old Egypt like that. When the old king had died, immediately one has to know to install the new king, because no king is awful. One can see it in now in Brazil, when they have no police, people are killed. The police are going on strike and they have no police. So the king is a very important installation, a very important archetype, but he is becoming old when in the long run he cannot renew himself. And so a new king has to come. And I think in many, many respects in institutions, it's always like that. Also in the Jung Institute, one has to look when everything is fine and very well organized and so on. This is dangerous. Then it becomes a rule, and then it will not change. One cannot make any exception, and so on. And so the people are used. It is go going very well and so on. And this is also the time of decay. New ideas, new people, new experiences, optimism and so on has to come and to bring a new spirit in it. This is the new king. And often the old institution doesn't want to be dissolved and renovated because it has a long tradition, and one is fond of this tradition, and this is very dangerous. It has always to change because life is transformation. This is also in the individual's life. If a person cannot transform anymore, is not creative anymore, then he's dead.
Or provokes that to others, therefore becomes evil.
Yeah, yeah. The old Adam, the old king. So I think this is the problem of our time.
But I understand you are full of hope, because you know that with transformation, things will continue transforming.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And therefore I have the idea when Jung will be discovered, really, not just made into Jung institutes here and there and so on, everywhere in the world, know that people are grabbed, taken by this vision of the psyche, that then something happens. Because I was director of studies in 69 to 71, and I got many letters from all over the world from people who told me they read Memories, Dreams and Reflections, and they were struck by this book. This is where something happens in a individual that appeals to it, and every single person who has this experience is the carrier of the spark of Jung into the future.
What are dreams?
Huh. This is a very difficult question, because easy and difficult at the same time. Easy is it's a message from the unconscious, or you can put it into religious terms, a message from the angels. There's a book about it. But the question is, to understand this message, what are we doing? How can we understand the message, the dreams? And this is, from this angle, I looked at it, it is difficult because there is no recipe to understand dreams. I cannot give you a schedule and say, here you can understand your dreams. this is very simple. No, every dream is a unique message. One has to know the person, one has to know the circumstances, one has to know the associations of the dream. and so on. So this is difficult. Marie-Louise was interpreting some archetypal dreams where she said, then I, for instance, from historical persons, she could know the person. She knows perhaps a book about the person, biography and so on. But these dreams she could interpret just because they were collective motives of the dreams. And this is proving what Jung said, that they are archetypal dreams. Archetypal means collective, are understandable for everybody on the world, whether Chinese or Negroes or Eskimos or Europeans, it doesn't matter. Something in the human being is producing these archetypal images. But this is also the reason why unit psychology is the psychology for the world. In every culture it can be understood. But the dream is nevertheless always beside collective individual, from the moment in which the dreamer was having his dream, it belongs to the very kairos, the moment. Only in this moment, this dream could happen. And therefore she was interpreting archetypal dreams, which is very interesting to see. But for me, it is a sign also that Jung psychology is worldwide, not restricted to a certain civilization, Christian Jewish civilization. No, it's worldwide.
Who was Marie-Louise von Franz?
She was a very nice lady, but very strict also. I am very grateful to her, because when I entered my training analysis in 63, then I had a huge negative mother complex, huge feelings of inferiority. But I had already read Jung's books. She told somebody, she never had met somebody who had already read all the books of Jung. Of course this was not, I have not read all, but a big amount of Jung's book. And then I interpreted my dreams from my knowledge of Jung psychology. I said, here is this archetype and this archetype, the shadow and the anima. When a dark figure was coming, then it was the shadow. When a light figure, a feminine, then it was the anima, and so on. And so I brought my dreams to her and my interpretation too. And she never said, no, this is bullshit, this is not right, never. I would have gone out immediately of her room when she would have reacted in this way. No, she gently took it and said, perhaps one could see it also from this side, on this perspective. And so she slowly, slowly put it to the bottom, because my interpretation was up in the air, of course, and she put it on the floor. And this I could accept, and made that after some years I realized one has to undergo one's own training analysis, I understood from Jung's writings. But I thought, of course, I have no problems. I'm just a normal person. I'm not ill. I'm not crazy. I don't need analysis. But after some years, I realized I have this and that problem. And so I'm the most poor patient myself. And this was a very important experience, because then I was no more the psychiatrist who could tell the people, look, here you have a problem, and you are diagnosed like that and that. No, I knew I myself need the analysis and to see my problems. And then only the dreams became meaningful to help me find my own way out of the problems. And this helped me also, because I said I am grateful for Marie-Louise von Franz that he was so tactful to become very tactful with my own clients and patients, because I knew how, what it happened to me, how it happened to me, that they are poor. And this is also the big resistance against Jungian psychology. One has to face one's own shadow, one's own dark side, which one doesn't like to know the people, the community, the general, and so on, which one puts behind the chair and into the corner that nobody sees. When I'm so bright and wonderful, then I want everybody to know. But my dark side, I'm carefully hiding because I'm ashamed. And so whoever can accept his own inferior side only can accept Jungian psychology. And this is why a general resistance is against Jungian psychology. This is exactly what we don't want to know of ourselves.
What is your suggestion, perhaps even wish, for those students, training candidate, diploma candidates at the institute here in Zurich, but Jungian institutes around the world? You are a wise man. You are in the lineage from Jung, von Franz, Ribi, and a few others. But there are students that are coming to train here and that train around the world. What would be your suggestion to them?
I saw always that those people, as you mentioned, there are many other young institutes in the world, which I asked, why are you coming for a long trip? For instance, Saturday, there was a lady from Hong Kong, which is studying here. Why are you coming for such a long trip? And then they said, because here, Jungian psychology is alive. It is from people who are still or have still the spark from Jung, which makes Jungian psychology alive. It's an experience, it's not a theory which you get here from the institute and from the people who are teaching you. And this is so important. This is the worth the long trip to come here. And I must say, among the pupils of von Franz, we often discussed it. It's also that somebody said, we can't prove it, but that Jungian psychology could only originate in Switzerland. Because you have to think, in the Second World War, Switzerland was the only island who was not involved in this worldwide war. An island where Jung was isolated often, and he complained in the letters, which you can read, that he was so isolated from his friends in England, in America, and everywhere, but that he could write his work, that Switzerland was prevented from being aggressed by all these states in war, to keep the peace here for Jung to write, because this was the important place in Bollingen where he was writing his work. And perhaps, at least symbolically, it is meaningful that a man who lived in isolation, in peace, put his ideas into this work, which could help the world who is caught in war to become more peaceful, to find a way out of this awful, destructive attitude. And perhaps the landscape also of Switzerland with the Alps. So it is the highest point of Europe where Jung was living, and he liked to walk in the mountains, and where all the rivers were going in the four directions to the sea. That this is also a symbolic center of Europe, where his psychology was originating.
Seems like Jung and von Franz trusted each other unconditionally, and they were linked by alchemy, the interest in alchemy. They are also very interested in alchemy. Mm-hmm. There are many ways to see alchemy and the alchemists.
Yeah, yeah.
What is alchemy, and what could do alchemy in 21st century?
Yeah, you know, von Franz had a dream when she had to decide what is she studying. Because she was gifted in mathematics, she was extraordinary pupil in mathematics, but in languages too, in old languages. So she didn't know, should she study math or old languages. And then she had a dream. She dreamed that the gods of Greece were coming and asking her for a gift. And then she knew this is old languages, Greek and Latin, she had to study. But during her studies, she got acquainted with Jung. And Jung was then gripped by Aurora Consurgens and told her this and so on. And then she did a critical edition of the text of our work on Surgens and wanted to have it accepted by her teacher for her thesis to end the Latin studies. But the teacher said, I don't deal with rubbish. So for him, alchemy was rubbish. So he didn't want to have to do anything with that. And this shows also how the attitude in general was before Jung. Now, many people speak about alchemy, and alchemy has become favorable. But before, it was nothing, rubbish. Because somebody had to see the meaning of alchemy, and this was not seen before. One thought alchemy is a forerunner of chemistry because they dealt with different substances, but they had no idea of chemistry, and so they had huge fantasies about their substances. But chemistry was a real science, and she developed out of alchemy. No, no, Jung said, this is not this way, because in alchemy, the irrational side, the mystical, the symbolic, is still there. And they didn't know much about the real chemistry, the rational side. And both sides are together in alchemy. Later on, the mystical side was rejected as something unnecessary, and chemistry could make a high flight. And but interesting enough, if you read Jung's Memories, Dreams and Reflections, he had ideas on his way to school of alchemical things, namely that there was a big ocean and a little island in which somebody was doing alchemical experiences and had a long chimney out of which substances were coming and substances were going in to be distilled and so on. So he, as a pupil, already where he couldn't understand anything of alchemy, really, had this fantasy. And von Franz too, she, as a girl in a gymnasium, she experienced make experiments with tar from the trees, from the pine trees, because she had heard that bernstein is a fossil tar from the pine trees. And so she wanted to produce this, because this is also an idea from the alchemist. It takes millions of years until it's fossil. But the alchemist can do this in a much shorter time by heating it up. So she took the tar and put it into a vessel and put salt also in it because it needed, and then it had to be heated. And then she told the tar, now you had to suffer the heat. It's not agreeable for you, but undergo this, and then after a while you will be a wonderful jewel. And this was an idea. But one day the whole thing exploded. And she was burned in the face, and the mother said, "What did you do?" And then she had to admit that she had done this, and she was forbidden to do it anymore. The same thing happened to me. I was always, as a student, experimenting. I had a room, a laboratory where I could do this. And one Sunday, the whole thing exploded, and I was full of glass in my face, and I have to watch. My mother saw it because I had to cross her room, and then she said, what are you doing? So I said, no, nothing, because I was bleeding. But this is that apparently there is an old strain in people which goes with the alchemical idea, which is not coming from outside. It's in people, some people, and apparently Jung was dreaming, von Franz was dreaming the same dream, and me too, without knowing each other. So it is something in man which is in this way. And therefore, the mystical part belongs to it. It's a loss that this mystical part is no more in chemistry. But I have to say, the chemists which I met in my life were all gripped by this mystical part too. They were doing scientific chemistry, but in the background, I saw it from their dreams, the mystical part is still present. So it belongs to it.
Once you said that alchemy would suggest the following. At night, a stranger knocks at your door. Alchemy suggests to open the door and to allow to start a conversation. If you don't do this, there will be stagnation. In a time where walls are built again, division are arising, what is your take?
I think you are quite right. This is perhaps a way where alchemy is coming back. Because I see now that a lot of people are interested in alchemy, but only because of their irrational side. So, it becomes a little bit esoteric. The esoteric people are drawn to alchemy. But this is not the right aspect of alchemy. It is another, as I told you from these experiments of Jung and von Franz as children or grown-ups, as puberty is at this time, it is a dream of mankind, a dream of transformation. And you know, in the Mars, you have the transformation too. This was always the danger that the church couldn't forbid alchemists to do their work, because they themselves spoke about transformation in the mass of the bread into the body, of the wine into the blood. And so this was a luck for alchemy that it was never forbidden. It was only once from not from the Pope, but this was only for a short time, but generally it was not forbidden. Probably also because the alchemists didn't have followers. They didn't make a community. This would be a rivalry to the church, and they exterminated all these Cathars and Albigens and all that. But the alchemists were never dangerous for the church because of the comparison of the transubstantiation in the Mass.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
It's been very, very interesting to listen to you.
Yeah. It's a long life experience.
It is indeed. And it's worth it. Perhaps this is the suggestion for our patients. It's worth it.
Yeah, yeah.
Never give up.
No, no. And this I see always when I can tell them a personal experience, then they get it. When I tell them a theory, it's boring. Not the same.